Hello, everyone, and welcome to our new live webcast. Everything you always wanted to know about FSBs, but were afraid to ask. Join us each month for new powerful messages, technical tips, and success stories that will leave you inspired and ready to get your protection, licensing, and security techniques another step closer to perfection. At Vibu Systems, we empower software publishers and intelligent device manufacturers with cutting-edge technologies, new business models, and tailor-made consulting training. Let us help you upgrade, optimize, and automate your entire license lifecycle management so you can focus on monetizing your business at a higher level. My name is Daniela Previtali, Global Marketing Director of Vibu Systems, and I'm delighted to have you here with us today. We are joined by Rüdiger Kugler, VP Sales and Security Expert, and Wolfgang Völker, Director of Product Management and Support, both from the headquarters of Vibu Systems. In the code meter universe, we always refer to firm security boxes as the primary keys to your secure licensing kingdom. Still, there are different types of FSBs that give you access to the complete array of functions or a subset only. Multiple FSBs you can own for the different roles you assign within your team, and two implementation options. You hold your own FSB, or we rather host your FSB in case you opt for a cloud-based compiler like Azure Pipeline. Some housekeeping we need to take care of before we start. For everyone who's joining us today, I want to remind you that we will be reserving some time at the end of the session for Q&A, and I'd like to invite you to submit any question you have in the live chat box. This session is being recorded, and a link to the replay will be posted directly to you in the next couple of days. And don't forget, stay with us throughout the live session for your chance to win 4 hours of free code meter consultation from the most brilliant minds at our company. At the end of the webinar, a new tab in your browser with three simple quiz questions will show up. You should submit multiple choices for each multiple answer question. We will draw the winner from among those who replied correctly and notify them at the time of the reply announcement. Please also note that the winner is excluded from all subsequent prize draws of 2021. Without further ado, I'll pass things over to Rüdiger. The floor is yours.
Kerckhoff's principle says that for a good security system, for a good cryptographic system, the key should be kept secret, but all the rest should be public. So all the algorithms, all the methods, all the things that you do inside should be available to the public so that everyone can take a look. And only the key is the only thing which needs to be secret. And we at Vibu Systems, we are following these guidelines already since the beginning in 1989 with our first product Vibu Key. And of course, we do the same with CodeMeter. And for keeping the key secret, the firm security box plays a very important role. And today we want to show you how the firm security box plays this important role. What are your benefits and what can you do with your firm security box? And with this, I'd like to welcome you to our webinar. Everything you always wanted to know about the FSB. And we will tell you something in the next 50 to 60 minutes about how the firm security box works. When we start, maybe a short introduction about firm code and the product code and how CodeMeter works in principle.
Just to remind about the license entries, we will have now this first slide and also a warm welcome from my side. A license entry consists mainly out of firm code and a product code. The firm code is issued by Vibu Systems to your company at the time you make the contract with us. And the product code can then be freely chosen by yourself. You have a lot of product codes available, so you can organize your products, your options, your modules, your features completely free out of more than 4 billion product codes. The only thing I always recommend, don't use product code zero. Sometimes you run in trouble with that on some error messages on asking for some special handles. Well, in a container, you can place a lot of different product items, up to 2,000. But this, of course, depends on the options that you additionally put into the license. Each option, of course, needs a few bytes, for example, an expiration time or some data, some text. This all needs some space. And the space at the end, especially in the CM dongle, in the hardware variant, is limited. But normally, it's not a problem to store all the stuff that you need to store, all the keys and all the information. So this short, first short overview about the license entries. And now let's a little bit go deeper to the firm code. We have had in the history of CodeMeter several kinds of firm codes, Rüdiger.
Yes, when we started with CodeMeter in 2003, 2004, we introduced our first firm code, the firm code 100,000. It was made for a CodeMeter dongle. At this time, CodeMeter consists of a big dongle where you can store up to the 2,000 license entries in one dongle. And the idea was to store multiple entries as much as possible, also entries from different vendors. And so that's why we created a system where we had one master key, one root key, and all the keys for all the different product codes were derived from the one master key. In 2006, we introduced a new system. We introduced the CMACT license, which is a soft license, which is bound to the properties of the computer, and which is an encrypted license file, which is located on the hard drive and in the memory, the keys are available. And here we thought, oh, it might be a better idea to have not one master key, which is used to derive all the product keys and say, hey, we have one master key for every product. And that's why we found out, oh, it's hard to make it compatible with the dongle firm code because it should work in a different way due to the security reasons. And that's why we introduced the second firm code. We call this the 5 million firm code or the CMACT license firm code. In 2015, we had the idea, oh, we should have a third type of container, code with a cloud container. In this case, all the licenses are bound to a user account in the cloud, and the container in the cloud is bound to the to some user login, something like similar to username password. We call this a credential file. And then we had the question, oh, should we take the dongle firm code? Should we take the ACT license firm code? Should we create something new? And then we came to the conclusion it would be great to have one firm code for all. And due to the fact that the dongle now has more memory, more space, we could bring the idea of having different master keys for the different products also to the dongle. Because now we have more space, more memory. We are not limited like we did or like we was in the first dongle of 2004. And that's why we introduced a new universal firm code, which is mainly based on the IDs of the 5 million firm code, but with some improvements, some certificate-based licensing. And so we introduced this universal firm code, which is now available for CodeMeter dongles, CodeMeter ACT licenses, and for CodeMeter cloud container, which are the three full CodeMeter compatible containers where you can use licensing, where you can use protection. And the CodeMeter Cloud Lite container is a lightweight implementation of the cloud licensing. And this is mainly made for licensing of software as a service applications. And so these are the three type of firm codes. Today we will cover most things of the 6 million firm code, but most of the things are very similar for the old 100,000 and 5 million firm codes. When we come to the firm codes, there's one file that you get from us, the CMFirm WPC. And Wolfgang, can you tell us more about the CMFirm WPC?
Yeah, this is a small file that you receive together with your license. That is, of course, most times delivered via software update, via update file to your FSB. But the CMFirm WPC file, you need to place on the systems that need to use the FSB. So this might be the developer system where you need to encrypt something. This is the build system, which needs to run the CodeMeter protection suite to protect your great software. And of course, this is also needed on CodeMeter license central systems or any other system that does the license programming. In this file, you see your number, your firm code number as a firm license, and some descriptions of the text, which is your company name, and some small settings that are not really interesting here at the moment. Normally, you get this file at the very first beginning, and it needs not to be changed over the years. Only, for example, if you rename your company because you have grown or have been bought by Google, whatever, then you might need to get a new one. So some of our ISVs sometimes struggle about this. For example, if you get a new system after 5 years, then you install all the software on it, and then you want first time to do the encryption, and then sometimes the ISV has forgotten that he needs this small file, but without this file it does not work. So yeah, please keep it and put it always on the systems where you need it. Also, additionally, on the files on the servers, if you host your FSB on a local LAN server, for example, to use it from several build systems or something like that. Well, so this is talked too much already about CM firm VVC because it's not so important. So let's now switch over to the firm security box itself.
Yeah, together with your firm, the CM firm VVC, WPC, you get your firm security box. Currently, we deliver this as a CodeMeter dongle, as a USB dongle. In general, this could be also possible to deliver this as an SD card or as an ASIC. And I call this as a master dongle. And in the master dongle, we have your firm code and, of course, the keys for your firm code. And by the way, one firm security box can host multiple firm codes. So let's assume you have different divisions, or let's assume you have bought a company and you want to bring everything to one master dongle. In this case, we can create your firm security box, which hosts all your firm code, so you can have more than one firm code in one FSB. And I told you that there were the cryptographic keys, and the keys were for the license creation and for the signature of the license. We will see later on that when we want to use a license, the license needs some keys for encryption and decryption, and they need to be derived from something. And this is one part. The second part, the license file that is created is signed, or the license update file which is created is signed, so that the CodeMeter runtime can find out this is a correct license update and I will accept the license update. Then you want to encrypt your software. We need a key for the encryption of your software. And of course, we need a key for the signature of the software. So if you want to use an integrity check or anti-tamper protection, in this case, your software can be signed, and maybe you have an EXE and then the dynamic link library. And then the Excel can check if it loads the library. Is the library signed? Is the library signed by you? And can check if everything is fine. And so the private key for the signature is in the firm security box, and the public key is put into your software to check if the other modules are signed by you as a software developer. There are two available options, delivery options. One is a standard firm security box, which can do all, which has all the keys and can do all with all the keys. The other option is a encryption-only firm security box, which only has the keys for the software encryption and for the software signature. This doesn't have the right to create licenses. And this encryption-only firm security box is mainly made for two different use cases. One use case is you have a build farm, so you have a continuous integration system. You have a build farm and you want to have this automatic protection with AX Protector in your automatic build process, then you need this firm security box, and you don't want to have a firm security box which can create licenses in your automatic build system. And the other one is if you have a software developer who should do this at home, or who should do this in another country, and in this case you also want to hand over to him in firm security box, which should not be able, or he should not be able to create licenses, but of course he should be able to use AX Protector to encrypt his software. So these are the two options where a firm security box is, or how is a firm security box is available. Yeah, as I mentioned, we need some keys for encryption and decryption. And Wolfgang, can you tell us more about the details, how the process works?
Yeah, in the process, at first we have a look from on the protection of the software. So you have written your new piece of great software, and of course this software should be protected so that your intellectual property remains at your side and is not spread all over the world. Only the users should use and profit from your great invention. So you want to protect your software with one of the tools of our CodeMeter protection suite. And the CodeMeter protection suite for this needs the FSB. The FSB then needs to simulate the calls that can be made later on. And for this, the FSB needs to know the firm and the product code. And from all of this, the correct encryption key is derived that is used to encrypt the software now, and that needs to be used later on to decrypt the software to run it at the user side. So with this encryption key and from the FSB, the protection is done, and then you get your protected software. And then we need a license. How do we get a license?
Yeah, on the other hand, we need to get a license, and for getting a license, you can have your ERP system, CRM, e-commerce system, and you can use CodeMeter License Central to create a license. Of course, you can also create a license manually. The workflow is nearly the same, not automated, but you use our tools like License Central with this user interface, or you use our license editor or command line tool. And also here, you need a firm security box. You need to define which firm code and product code should be created. And of course, for the decryption of the software, you need the same key which was used for the encryption of the software. And that's why in the license, the same key needs to be placed or needs to be written into the license. To be more accurate, we don't write exactly the key in the license with which the software is encrypted. We write some key, and from the key, we derive the key which is used for the software encryption, decryption. But let's say we write a key in the license which is connected to firm code and product code. And with this, now we create a license. And so in the license, which could be either a cloud-based license, which could be a CM Act license, which is bound to the computer, which could be a dongle-based license, we have now the license with the fitting decryption key. And of course, the software and the license is delivered to the user. And as mentioned before, the encryption key needs to be the same like the decryption key, because otherwise you could not decrypt the software which was encrypted on your build system or on your local computer. So let's now take a look how we do the key derivation in the dongle or in the license. And here, when we take a look at the license or at the dongle, we have different options. We have the firm code, we have the product code. Then in the product item, we have the feature map, which could define different versions of a software, which could define different features of a software. Both is possible. We have the maintenance period, which is mainly used for maintenance contracts. We have other options like an expiration time, like a license quantity, like a usage period, like a unit counter. And so different other options are available, and they are available in the license or in the dongle. And these are the visible options, so everyone can see these options, that this license is there. But under the hood, there is, and we call this the product item secret key, there's a secret key which is strongly connected to the product code. So every product code has its own product item secret key. And by the way, for every firm code, this product item secret key is also different. So it's different for every combination of firm code and product code. And this is the key, which is the secret, the initial secret, the main secret, which is used for the encryption and decryption of your software. But of course, it is not used in a plain way. And Wolfgang tells us how to use this key from the API.
Yeah, at first on the API, you make an access to get the entry address that you want to use for a decryption encryption, and then you need to set to the function cmcrypt, for example, all the options that you want to be used for the key derivation. So the firm code and the product code are fixed and clear, need to be the ones. Then you have the feature code, which is a subset of the feature map. You have the option to use a release date. So for this, you can ensure that your software it can only be used if the customer has bought the matching maintenance period for this kind of software. And this also goes into the key derivation. Additionally, there are some encryption code options. For example, you can set for security reasons some bonus option like that an expiration time needs to be there, so the license will not do the correct encryption sequence if there is no expiration time, some options like this. And then you have the encryption code, which is something that you can choose freely by your own. You have another 4 billion options to set this encryption code. This allows you especially to vary the encryption results if everything else remains the same, but you want to vary to ensure that this cannot be seen directly. But of course, on decryption, you need to know the exactly same encryption code. This is something, for example, that is placed within the protected software, because we then need to know with which encryption code was used for this. And then, of course, we have the data that we want to encrypt or decrypt. And now, at first, the data that should be done with a or encrypted with an AES, we need at first the key for the AES. And this key is a hash from all the stuff that we are using in the different options. So the firm code, the product code, the feature code, exactly the feature code, not the complete map, the release date from the maintenance period, and all the stuff I already told. And especially the product item secret key goes also to this. And therefore, the hash value as a result is always completely different if some of these options vary. And then this hash, this is the real key that goes to the AES and is used to encrypt or decrypt the data. That's how it works.
Yeah, so we see that the product item secret key is the important secret which is connected to every license. Before we come to the question how it is created, let's take a look at the firm security box entries. So which entries are in a firm security box? And let's start with the evaluation firm security box. So if you say I want to test CodeMeter, then you get a CodeMeter dongle with three firm codes, 99, 100,021, and 102,688. Let's first start with the 99 and with the 102,688. And in the 99, we have the product code 6,010,000. And so this is like a chain. So our firm code is the 99. Your firm code is the product, is the 6,010,000. And so our product code is your firm code. And so when you see here in 99, 6,010,000, this means your firm code is 6,010,000. You can do something with 6,010,000. Of course, this is the public available firm code, so everybody can use it. And so, of course, your software would not be really protected if you would use the 6,010,000 for real production purposes. And this entry is used as the key store. On the next slide, we will dive a little bit deeper into which keys are there and for what they are used. The second entry that we see here, the CodeMeter demo license, so the product code 100,000 in 102,688. This is the license which we grant to you so that you can use the evaluation firm security box. And this one is a license which until the 1st of August this year, 2021. And usually this is a license which works for a limited period of time. And Wolfgang, can we explain a bit more about the keys that we have in the key store?
Yeah, so in the key store, we now see the details. At first, there's just the description text. This consists of your company name, in this case, well, the Universal Firm Code Test Kit. And in brackets, we see the way of licensing that we are using, that we have, yeah, it's a contract with you. In this case, for the demo license, it's an unlimited version. We will see later on about the different modes. In the feature map, we have a lot of different feature bits, and each feature bit stands for some cryptographic operation or for some, yeah, business operation also. So for example, there is a different bit that is used if you add a firm code first time to a CM container. There is a bit that is used if the product item is added, one if product item is updated, and so on. And there are some additional bits, for example, one for doing encryption of data. And so playing on this different feature bits, then we can configure the different types of FSBs. For example, the encryption only FSB, of course, then has not all the bits that are needed for programming. And additionally, in the next entry, we have a small certificate, which shows then us how we should charge for using the different features. So this is always in the other extended bracket data, it's the same. This is a small certificate, just the data of the certificate, not the structure, because we also want to save some space, of course. And within there, we have defined in detail that for feature bit number 4 or whatever, a special entry of the charging of 102.688 should be used. And this is defined here and is different, of course, for the different licensing models. And at the end, you will find a signature so that CodeMeter software, CodeMeter SDK components can always check that the data that are derived from there are originally issued by Weavoo Systems. At the end, when the certificate is blown up, so it's put into its infrastructure, then it looks nearly like a X509 certificate. So yeah, we just work with standards. We just shrink it a little bit to save some space.
And to make it cleaner and to make it more fast and more efficient. That's why we use methods of X509, but have it in our own binary and compact format. And there are more than this. There are more certificates in the key store. And additionally to the certificates, there are also some keys. And let's first take a look at two keys, at a licensor private key and the licensor transfer key. I already mentioned that the license is signed, so that CodeMeter only imports a license which comes from you as your software developer. So there is a signature with your licensor private key, which is in your firm security box, which, by the way, never leaves your firm security box. And so when you create a license, the license update file is signed with your license or private key, and there's a fitting certificate under this lot of certificates. There's one license or private key certificate, which we create in the firm security box and which makes sure that CodeMeter can check your signature, can find out this is a real, genuine signature created by you as the owner of this firm code. When we created the universal firm code, we had the idea, we want to have a license move, an offline license move. So this is a requirement that we got from a lot of customers. And there are two use cases. One use case is I want to borrow a license temporarily to a computer. So maybe I flow the network licenses on the license server. And one employee needs to leave the company for a couple of days and he should work offline with the software. And so he wants to borrow the license from the license server. And on the other hand, we have some field engineers who should bring a license, maybe with a Coop Meter dongle, and should put the license into some computers at a plant in some industrial environments. And in this case, a license should be moved mainly from a dongle. It's also possible from a laptop, but I would not recommend this due to security reasons, but mainly from a dongle to a computer in an industrial environment. And here we had a great idea. We can sign the complete license with the license of private key and make sure that this license is not changed. But if we want to transfer a license, we need to change the binding and say, hey, this license now no longer belongs to this computer. Now the license belongs to this computer. And therefore, we need a key. And we don't want to deliver the license of private key to change this to the user. And that's why we create a second key, the license of transfer key. And with the transfer key, we are able to change the binding of the license. And so if you create a license which is transferable, the license will include the license or transfer key in a hidden field in the license, not readable. And when the license then is offline moved, offline borrowed, the new binding is signed with the license or transfer key, making sure that the license works correctly on the new device then. And on the endpoint, the license or transfer key is not available. So meaning when the license is borrowed to an endpoint, let's say from a dongle or from a license server to a local machine, then the license or transfer key is no longer the local machine. Or when you create a license which is not transferable, of course, the license or transfer key is also not in this license. So we only put it where it's really needed. We don't put it anywhere. We put it only in these places where it is really needed. And I think this is a real cool stuff to have a very good option of the security by easy usage of the licenses. There are two more keys, and Wolfgang, can you tell us more about the two remaining keys?
Yeah, we have from the very first beginning the so-called firm key and the firm root key, then for universal firm codes now. And the firm key is the secret that is used for key derivation, for getting all the keys derivated that are necessary later on. So, for example, at the end, the product item secret key is influenced by the setting of the firm root key. And it is in general possible to change the firm root key of a firm code, but warning, you need to do this at the very first beginning of working with a new firm code. Because if you later on change this key, everything gets incompatible. So the stuff that is newly created has different keys than the licenses and software that has been created or protected before changing this. And of course, then you need to keep the firm key, the new firm key, secret and safe, because you need it. Otherwise, you will never be able to create another FSB or to modify an FSB in a way that it can create compatible licenses. So this is something where you have the chance to get rid of the risk that Weebu would be able to create a firm security box that does the same encryption as yours does, but with the risk that you need to take care about the firm key and you need to keep it secret. And we can tell you from history that we have had customers that at the end lost their firm key and then at some time needed to change everything to a new firm code because they were not able to create new licenses. So you need to know about this. And most customers don't do this because I always say at the end, you have to trust at Weebu when you use our protection software.
I would say that the risk that we do something to harm you is very, very low, because inside the Weebu systems, we have also, we call this a WSB, a Weebu security box, which is needed to create a firm security box. and there are only a limited amount of people who can do this. There is a system which makes a protocol every time when we create a firm security box. So the risk that we create a firm security box for you, which is used somewhere else, is very, very low. So to change the firm root key, I don't remember many customers who did this. Technically, it's possible, but I would say the risk to lose the firm root key and to change everything is higher than to trust Vibu. So I would trust Vibu. But yeah, you, of course, we are free. And so if you say you want to change this, you can do this, of course. Yeah, let's continue with the license entries. And before we come to the license entries, a few words to the license models. And we're offering three license models that you can choose between of the licensing between you and us. The standard license that we mainly use, mainly sell, is our license per Kubernetes container, meaning when you want to program a license into a dongle, you pay once and then you can program as multiple product code that you want to program. You can change them, you can add them, you can delete them. So you pay once per Kubernetes container. So you have a fee for the hardware and you have a license fee to use the hardware, because one of the major features of Kubernetes is that you can also use a hardware which is already there. So for instance, if you are a developer of software which is running on a PLC, a lot of PLC vendors already use Kubernetes, like BNR, and then you can use the dongle which is already delivered by BNR and put your own licenses also inside the BNR dongle. And in this case, of course, you only need to pay the license per container, or the license for your firm code, and you don't need to pay the hardware because the hardware is already there. And so the license per container for a soft license is a license per every computer, and for a dongle, every container is assigned to one user, so at the end it's a license per user, and then you can change the license unlimited times. There are two additional options, trial licenses and protection only licenses. And these are two license types where the license is not bound to a specific computer. So this license or this license file can then be distributed to multiple computers. And that's why the trial license has an annual license fee and the protection only license too. Since 2 years, we have a more modern system. We call this IP protection. And the protection-only license is mainly used if you want to protect your software against reverse engineering, but you don't want to use Kubernetes for licensing. So maybe for a free version or for a freemium version, where you want to activate features later, and then you want to encrypt your software, and you don't want to use the licenses, or you don't want to use Kubernetes licensing for the whole application. And for this use case, now we have since 2 years the IP protection, which can be used for the same purpose, but you don't need to deliver a license. So with the old one, with the protection only, you need to create a dummy license, need to deliver the dummy license with your software. But with the new IP protection, you simply encrypt your software, deliver your software, no need to install something, no need to install something with administration rights. So the new IP protection is better. That's why we put this already here in gray. So if you want to have, or if you have this use case, I would recommend to talk with us about the IP protection. The second license model is the license per transaction. In this license model, there's a fee for every product code, not for every container, but for every product code that you create and that you change. So if you have the use case, I'm creating one license with one product code, that's it. There are no changes over the years, so no subscription. There are no changes because the user is a floating network license and users typically change the amount of users. There's nothing like I have modular licensing, feature on demand, where I can add additional product codes or module items to activate or deactivate different features, to have a set of features. For all these cases, the standard model is better, or the license per container is better. The license per transaction only fits if you have a single license that you never touch again. Also here, IP protection, protection only and trial licenses are available. And last but not least, the unlimited licenses, which is an annual flat fee, which includes everything. And in this case, you can create as multiple licenses as you want. You pay an annual fee, and then you can create multiple containers. And now let's take a look at a sample of such an entry. And here in our demo key, we have now additional entries. And one additional entry is the entry 99, 6,370,000. And this is a license that we created for ourselves for the test purposes. And this is a license per container, so a standard license. Here we have the key store. By the way, the keys are the same that we already know from the evaluation firm security box. And the second entry is here, and this is a license per container. And here we're using the product code 1 in the firm code 102688. And here we see that we have 100 licenses, so we can create 100 containers or 100 firm items to be more accurate. And Wolfgang, can you tell us more about the details of this license entry?
Yeah, the details that we see here is just the unit counter of 100. So if you then later on use one of our programming software pieces to create such a new firm item, then this unit counter is reduced by one and then will remain on 99. And so you can use it. And later on, if you buy something new, then we will refill to the value in charge of the number of licenses you have bought. The next area is the license information with the, where the reseller is written on one hand as a text so that it's readable. Who has issued this license? Who is the responsible reseller? This, in this case, is here Weibo Systems in Germany, the headquarter. Or this can, of course, be Weibo US. This can be Weibo Systems in Japan, whatever. And additionally, this is written down in the extended protected data area. There is the internal number of this reseller. And with this, we have a territorial protection. So additional licenses can only be applied from the same reseller where you have bought the original license. So this ensures that our resellers and our offices can do their job and can have a separate customers they take care of. The other entries is a customer ID where the customer number itself. So you get a customer number from us at Weibo when you get your firm code, latest also if you buy it over a reseller. And that's it, what is interesting in these details of a license entry. So we have seen now, have looked at the license per CM container. Now let's have a short look at the license per transaction. So it looks the same, of course, in the brackets you see that it's per transaction. And of course, the entry where we count the number of transactions is a different one. It's now the product code 2 where we store the licenses per transaction. Well, in this sample, it's also 100, but this is for 100 times adding or changing a product item, or to be more specific, a product item or a module item. Yeah, that's it for the license per transaction. And then, yeah, we have this additional trial license we have already seen. Rudiger, what is about this?
Yeah, so it's the same like we saw with the per transaction and per container. We have the key store where the keys are stored, and we have an entry in the 102688. Now this is the product code 4, and this is this trial license. As I mentioned before, it has an expiration time. So this is a license which is on an annual base. Yeah, and last but not least, you see the unlimited license. So a license where you can create multiple licenses or unlimited license within a time frame. And here it's the same, we have the key store. And here we're using product code 5. And also here is an expiration time similar to the trial license. And with this, you can create unlimited amount of licenses in this 1 year. And this license will expire on the 1st of April in 2022. And last but not least, I told you that these are firm security boxes to create licenses, but there's also one for the encryption only. Wolfgang?
Yeah, this encryption only FSP is now different, and this is an add-on that you can have on all three different types of licensing models that we have had before. So it does not depend on the licensing model. This is just FSB that can be used for protecting the software, for signing software, for doing encryption. And this encryption only FSB does not need an additional entry for charging this, because this is an everlasting entry, and you can use this encryption only FSB for a long time, for example, on your build system or wherever you need it.
Yeah, renewing licenses is very easy and simple, and it's the same process. It doesn't matter if it is an account-based license, so like the transactions or like the containers, or like if it is a time-based license, I like the trial license or the unlimited license. You call your local reseller or your sales partner, and they will create a ticket for you. This ticket is an activation code. Then you go to https://license.vibu.com. And on license.vibu.com, you enter your ticket, and then you can see either the amount of licenses or the expiration time. And then you need to connect your firm security box and click activate licenses, and then that's it. By the way, if you have more than one firm security box, in this case, you can also split the licenses and say, hey, let's put 90 licenses on the major or the main firm security box, and let's put another 10 on the spare firm security box if you want to. At the beginning, we saw that there are three different firm codes, and I promised you that we will tell you more about the second firm code, which is in there, and Wolfgang will tell you more about what is this firm code made for, the 100,021.
Yeah, this 100,021 firm code is used to protect our own products. So the CodeMeter Protection Suite consists of several variants of AX Protector, and the AX Protector software itself is also protected, of course, with our own mechanisms. So to use an AX Protector, you need a license, and this license is stored and placed here in 100,021, and this is a license that is not limited. So you see there is no expiration time or something else. You can just use it, and you don't need to pay for an update, for getting newer versions of our CodeMeter Protection Suite, because we think it's very important that you always use the latest protection technology to protect your intellectual property. And this should not be covered by, oh, should I invest another $500 to buy the next update? So, because also the bad guys improve their techniques, and therefore you need also to use the latest protection software, where we have improved our technology. So these are just the standard entries that you have in every FSB. There are, of course, some other options that can be bought additionally.
Yeah, and one of those options is the IP protection option, as mentioned before. So if you have the use case, you want to encrypt your software without a license, or you want to have a basic version which starts without a license, and then you might want to add some features on demand or some in-game or in-application purchases, like a freemium version. And for this, you need the IP protection license so that you can encrypt your software, but without any license. And so this is the firm code 100,021 and the product code 1600 IP protection license for Protection Suite. And with this license, you are able to protect your software, but without any license. This is also an annual license. And so you see here, this license in my case is valid until April next year. To use the license, you need some signatures in the software. And so if you have your real firm code, you can take the license or private key from a real firm code. If you don't want to use a real firm code, then you can, of course, use the keys from the CodeMeter test kit. And so that's why in this case, the key store is the 6,010,000. But of course, if you have a real license, then you can combine this also with a real license. So
combinations are possible. If you ask us what are the best practice scenarios for firm security boxes, we found out there are three main scenarios. One is a small company or a single developer. Usually you get a standard, one standard firm security box. You use this for encryption and for creating your licenses. You have this in your drawer and that's it. If you are a company and you have your continuous integration, then of course you want to have an encryption only firm security box, which is connected to your automatic build farm. And you can have either one or you can have multiple. So if you want to encrypt on your software or build your software on multiple lines at the same time, then maybe it's better to have multiple encryption only firm security boxes for the cryptographic operations. And so you see here, this is possible. And usually you have one standard firm security box at Kubernetes License Central to create your licenses. And last but not least, the third scenario. So if you have a high amount of licenses that you want to create, that you want to delete, that you want to replace, so a lot of things, of course, you also might have the requirement for the continuous integration. So one or more encryption only firm security boxes at your build system. And then you can have multiple lines of License Central. And our recommendation is to have one firm security box for every line. And maybe additionally, you can have one spare firm security box, which acts as a failover, so that if the connection to one of the firm security boxes from one line fails, this one line can connect to the spare firm security box, or if the licenses are empty, which should not happen, but if this happens, you can use a spare firm security box to continue with your operation. And maybe Wolfgang can tell you more from our experiences from our hosting at WOPS.
Yeah, in our hosting with Weibo Operating Services, we, of course, also need to ensure that we don't have the single point of failure. So therefore, we have, especially for the high availability systems, we have more than one FSB. And normally, we use them in a crossover scenario, so that from the FSB from line one is used mainly from line one, the FSB for line two is used from line two. But if one of the FSBs is not available, it uses the other one. This is done with having separate FSB servers that host the FSB functionally and can then be used from different machines. This is one option, or you really prepare one FSB that is a hot spare maybe for several lines and can be used like this. But it's always important if you want to have high availability that you really don't have a single point of failure. Okay, that's it about the best practice scenarios. And now let's have a look about the delivery options, because that's something new. What we until now always have had is the delivery of the FSB with as a CM dongle. Standard in USB form factor, but if you need it in another one, you can get it also in another one. This can be also created remotely. So if you already have CM dongles at your site, we can just program the FSB entries via remote programming to your container. And so a standard CM dongle becomes then a firm security box. So this is perfect and works fine if you have the possibility to use hardware in your environment. But in the past, we have seen a lot of times that the customers get more and more the requirement that they need the possibility to use an FSB, but they don't have the option to plug in a dongle. For example, you run your systems for the build in an environment which is highly virtualized. Maybe you do this somewhere in Azure or somewhere else, and you are not able to plug in an FSB, and then you need to think about how to provide this. And for this, we now have set up the solution that you can use the CM dongle, the FSB, via CM1. And with this, we provide an encryption-only FSB. And this is newly available as an option for the Weibo operating services. And This CM1 technology is not new. We have invented this several years ago because of the request that we need something that can be managed very easily on the user side. For small companies that don't have an admin, for example, a small office with designers or someone like this, they don't have technical knowledge. And so the license itself should not be at their side. It should be somewhere else and someone else will manage it. For this, we have set up this CM1 scenario, so the wide area network for hosting code meter entries. And this is done by setting just a server search list entry to the code meter runtime. And then the CM1 connection works as a normal code meter license server in the network. But of course, with the difference that it does not use our special port 22350, that of course would be blocked at some time if you go to the internet. We just use standard technology. Also here, we use HTTPS and digest authentication for this. And then the reverse proxy will get the request with the digest authentication. It's checked that you are allowed to use this FSB. And then your request is forwarded to the code meter runtime service in the data center. And you then can do what you want to do. For example, encrypt the software with code meter protection suite. On the runtime side, on your side where you want to use the code meter protection suite, the code meter protection suite just goes via API interfaces, via standard API, and then goes to the code meter runtime service, and then it uses the server search list entry. Only thing you need to think of is that this was changed for code meter protection suite in version 10.70a, which is the latest version. It's coming together with code meter SDK 7.20a. For this, we added that the access to a WAN is automatically done also from all different kinds of AX protectors. So you can use this easily from out your DevOps environment, from your Azure pipeline, wherever you are, and you don't need to discuss with your data center, with your IT department, how to get this dongle connected to some system in the virtualized environment. And this is the first step, and the next step that will be done later this year is to provide another solution for this.
Yeah, and another solution is to have a firm security box as a code meter cloud container. So this is something we plan for the end of this year, for Q4 2021. And this option will be available only for the universal firm code. Technically, this is there's a restriction, so we cannot offer this for the other two firm codes. So it will be available for the universal firm code. And then you get a credential file, and the firm security box is in the Vibo cloud, and we operate and we provide you the firm security box in our cloud. Yeah, with this, we are at the end of our presentation. I would like to say thank you already very much for your attention. And I saw that there were some questions in the chat, and one question, I guess Wolfgang can answer this question very well.
Which question?
The security of the CM-WAN.
Yeah.
So how is the security of CM-WAN?
Yeah, the security of CM-WAN is okay. So you don't need to bother about someone else that could get your credentials, your username or password from this. You get from us, you get a sequence that you just add to your server search list. This can be done in the CodeMeter web admin, just adding this, and then you press apply. And after this, the password disappears and is stored securely within the CodeMeter environment. And then you see where to go and which is the user. Additionally, you can use CMU to import this server search list entry. And that's all you need to do. Then everything else is done as described before. It's the communication is HTTPS. So there's no chance to get some information about the password of this because this is done with digest authentication. If you are a little bit afraid, there should be some more restriction, then we have the option, if the Weibo operating services also to restrict the access to this to some special IP addresses. So for example, if you run this in your company network, then we can restrict the access to your encryption only FSB over CM1, for example, to your external IP addresses from your company. So this is an additional option. I don't think this is really necessary, but this is an additional option. Yeah, that's about the security. There was just another question at the very first, after a few slides of this session. And this is about the compatibility of the CM dongle. So an ISV has asked, he has already dongles in the field for several years. And so he has dongles starting with serial number 1- and then so on. And the question is, can these dongles also work with the new universal firm code?
I mentioned before that the old dongles had less memory and we need more memories for the layout of the new licenses because we have now this product item secret key in every entry. And so we need more memory and the old dongles with the 1 and the 2- don't have enough capacity to have the universal firm code. So 1 and 2- are not possible. For the 3- dongles, for all which is 3-3, 4, 4 or higher, the universal firm code is available. For the area between the 3 and the 3, 3, 4, 4, it need to be checked individually. At the end, the 3-3, 4, 4 was we started delivering this 5 years ago. So every dongle which was delivered in the last 5 years, let's say every mainstream USB dongle which was delivered in the last 5 years, should be able to be used with the universal firm code. Older dongles, especially the 1- and 2-, cannot be used.
Okay, this have been all the questions from the chat in this session. So nothing more to say, nothing more to ask. So therefore, I think we are at the end of our session and I want to say thank you for joining us. Bye bye and stay optimistic.
Yeah, I hope that we could show you that we don't do security by obscurity, that we are following the Kerckhoff's principle, that we say only the keys need to be secret and all the rest is public available. And maybe you found also some interesting inputs for your own licenses like this transaction or this territorial protection model. And so with this, I'd like to say thank you for your attention and stay healthy and have a nice day. Bye-bye.